I don't think I'm out of place in saying the Snyderverse and Nolan's trilogy before it were constrained, either on the part of the director or producers, by an element of realism. They wanted to tell stories that were grounded in a world that we could recognize. This was met with both acclaim and ridicule within and outside of the film industry. And then, after Warner Brothers had their storied creative departure from their directors, the studio made changes they believed would shift their stories to a more fun narrative. Again, this was met with both acclaim and ridicule. Am I okay in saying that? Alright, cool. Let's talk about why there's actually more realism in James Gunn's colorful and spontaneous The Suicide Squad than there is in Trailer Park's amateur edit of Suicide Squad. What's the standout vehicle of 2016 Suicide Squad? For most, it would be the purple Lamborghini lurking. Don't say it, because it's not a purple Lamborghini, guys. It's not.
And I'm tired of pretending it's not.
It is. The vehicle is called Evader, and that's a name offered by its designer, Matt McIntegert, to explain a body kit on a 2003 to 2007 Infiniti G35 coupe. So not only do we have a movie that has a fake Lamborghini, which would be okay if by all accounts it wasn't marketed as a Lamborghini, but then we have this fun little music video, the title of which being Purple Lamborghini, which hits hard when you're three sets into a strength training regimen. However, there is neither a purple Lamborghini nor the purple Vader in its 4 minute and 22 second runtime. This is just a side road that goes to show that Warner Brothers was in the attitude of faking intelligence and rewriting narratives as early as 2015, when pre-production for Suicide Squad was happening, as opposed to the popular belief that everything went to crap within the DC Films division in April of 2016, after Batman v Superman's critically dismal reception. I really want to see the Ayer cut. I think it'd be cool and novel and fun. I'm not as desirous for it as I was with Zack Snyder's Justice League, but the Vader was either an intentional early choice, and they were going to stick with calling it a Vader, which makes sense. It's cheaper to drop an Infiniti into a river than a Lamborghini. Or some producer was like, that looks a lot like a Lamborghini. Yo, what if we got some of the most popular music creators from the two most popular genres of last year and had them do a collab about this car? And David Ayer was in the background going, but it's not a Lamborghini. And the producer responds with, it doesn't matter, it won't even be in it. The music video is just going to have Jared Loker in his cosplay. Did you just call it cosplay? Yeah, don't interrupt. Anyway, he's just gonna walk around some clubs. And then another producer joins in and says, it'd be cool if they were all in a boat too, and what if the Joker has a cane? David's all like, guys, we're not even done with the movie. And they're responding like, ha, you are. We're bringing in the people who cut the trailer together to edit the rest of the movie. Yeah, also, we hate you. At least, that's how I imagine it went down, because the Purple Vader is really cool and solidifies the true, unique aspect to Joker lore, but then the production design just gets ruined by the producers after all the work has been done. Anyway, I just needed to make sure that I recognized the Vader against the studio identification of a Lamborghini to my audience. Some of my video watchers will look at the title and say,
you're wrong!
Without watching, so explaining how a 1983 and 1987 Chevy Blazer is called a 1980 Blazer by Netflix Studios was difficult. But fortunately for us, the studio interference isn't what happened with 2021's The Suicide Squad. Here's some history for you. I think everyone knows the general overview of how DC got their hands on James Gunn. A soul brought to light all of James Gunn's tweets of terrible taste. It appeared to be for nefarious purposes, but it's a personal belief of mine that you should be accountable for your past. I'm an addict myself and have to wrestle with that past and hope for a better future every day. So for better or worse, I think James Gunn handled his poor past appropriately. I don't think Disney did, but they fired James Gunn from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 anyway. This was after he had hired all of his pre-production team and began concept art and production work. There is a point to this story. Many directors, when they get hired for another project, end up rehiring their past production crew just to make the communication process flow and hopefully make the filming process more natural when it comes to rolling the camera for the first take. Wes Anderson and Christopher Nolan have a history of working with the same actors. James Mangold likes working with the same production designer. Zack Snyder has a favorite director of photography. Anyway, it's easy to collect your dream team as you continue your career and just stick with that dream team. That's not what James Gunn was doing for Guardians' third installment. In the early days of hiring for Guardians Volume 3, he went to his producers at Marvel and asked for the most inclusive production designers, costume designers, and across the board, he made it a priority to showcase some of the quieter voices in the film industry. He kept some repeats, but one of those new hires was production designer Beth Mickel. Her work includes the Ryan Gosling-led Drive of 2011 and the Will Smith and Margot Robbie pairing of 2015's Focus, so some fairly small yet recognizable productions. Save for perhaps 2014's Lost River, her work rarely involved fantasy or sci-fi elements. This was a big risk for James Gunn, and then he got fired from Volume 3 along with the rest of his crew. When DC hired James Gunn in the following months, he brought Beth Mickel along to develop the production design for this movie. So not only did she land a major Marvel movie, which she returned to upon Marvel's rehiring shenanigans, but she'll have both a DC and Marvel movie under her belt after a collection of movies that never passed $61 million production budget. So explaining the role of a production designer quickly, Beth had to create a cohesive look for each scene of the movie. In the Suicide Squad, we have the prison, jungle, Thinker's Club,
La Gatita Amable,
Corto Maltese Capital, and Jotunheim. All but Belrive are set within the fictitious island of Corto Maltese. So, many of the locations needed to appear as if they had similar heritage or culture. It didn't necessarily need to look the same across the Southern American Caribbean island, but there needed to be some consistent themes. The primary theme that James Gunn and Beth Mickel would land on is color. James Gunn wanted each scene to progress the vibrancy and variety of color both throughout the existing scene and with each subsequent scene. Think about the progression of the movie. Belrive to the jungle, we have very limited colors set up in the scene. In Belrive, we start with cool gray and orange en savant, moving on to multicolored dots on the walls. In the helicopter, we have a lot of red and dark. The jungle is a lot of cooler toned green. Once we board the bus, a lot of yellow light is illuminating the set. But after that, we have to split the narrative for both Harley and the rest of the still-living task force. La Gatita Amable and the capital of Corto Maltese explode with colors. And for the most colorful character, Polka Dot Man, the club is where he really comes alive. In the capital, the flowers and parrots, the gold and ivory, the blood and fire, there is just so much color involved in the capital set. But what vehicle transported them to these colorful set pieces? A blue and yellow bus with floral interior accents. For the main team previous to boarding Milton's bus, a lot of the movie was held in dimly lit sets. Either the sun was shining through densely grown trees, or it was nighttime and the light came from either fire or streetlights. After the squad passes through this wonderful color explosion, the exposure brightens, and we have a white backdrop for the main team to initiate Harley's escape. We get all of the colors, including the suits and the bus, in the most unobtrusive lighting, meaning the light isn't changing how any of the colors appear, and of course, we have Harley vision on full, beautiful display. One of Beth Mickel's favorite colors is turquoise, and you get to see it in two of my favorite set pieces, Harley's escape, led through a turquoise hallway, and the Toyota Coaster bus. Beth Mickel took the objective to play with and progress the color in an amazingly ridiculous but grounded way. She killed it. I mean, how do you make a giant pink and blue starfish believable? You really can't. But somehow, I mean, you can either set Starro in an environment that is all gray and black and, I don't know, maybe there's a spire of energy in the background and have the squad do their thing and the movie is over. But while Starro begins his rule over Corto Maltese in the washed out grays of Jotunheim, Starro moves to the small nearby city, progressing the scene into a more colorful location before our collective of colorful characters coordinate the climactic confrontation. You are absolutely allowed to say that the movie you're watching doesn't look colorful, and you can be right, but that doesn't mean Beth wasn't doing her job. The set itself, the produced backdrop of every scene, is full of variety, and what you view as color comes through the lens, lighting, and color grade. That part, though equally important, isn't Beth's job. Beth Mickel could have produced another desaturated final boss battle, but instead she requested a specific street in Colón, Panama, with just the right amount of playful color. Sure, if you're blind, you could say it's just another gray movie. But then you miss out on the orange storefront, the red and yellow umbrella, there's a freaking blue satellite dish. All of these little details are what made these disparate yet vibrant characters so cohesive when they finally come together. This is reading more like a pretentious video essay than it is a breakdown of the vehicle. We'll get back to it here shortly, but hopefully this detour was enough to help you appreciate the artistic vision behind the movie, and specifically the Toyota Coaster's interior design and paint job. This vehicle took all of my research prowess to get the identification right, and I can't even get it to the year like I usually like to. But most picture cards on screen have backups on set, and a lot of times those backups are from a different year than the primary vehicle, so I don't feel as bad for it this time. The Toyota coaster is an automotive staple in the bus scene, being sold nearly everywhere globally aside from Europe and North America, where Volvo and Greyhound are more recognizable. Volvo Bus's plant in Mexico also means that the Toyota coaster battles heavy competition in Central and South America, leaving the Toyota coaster a top seller really only in Bolivia, Panama, Peru, and the Caribbean. We've already gone over how a primary set location for the fictional island of Cuartel Maltese was the country of Panama. The coaster bus has gone through 4 generations, the most recent update occurring in 2016. The bus we see in the Suicide Squad belongs to the second generation, which was built between 1982 and 1992, with the third generation taking over in January of 1993. But if you do a standard search for the second generation bus, designated as a B20, B30 model, then it'll be hard to find, not only because of the vibrant color scheme, but because the headlights and passenger door belong to 2 of the lower level trim options. The trim levels made at the launch of the second generation in May of 1982 were the Deluxe, the EX, the Cooler, and the standard bus trim. Each of these had variants of their own, with a 29, 26, or 20 seat configuration. The coasters these days are released with 22 seats, so some clarification needs to be given to those high seating numbers. What those numbers really mean is there are 29 available locations for passengers to be. There may or may not be seats installed. The standard bus given to the Suicide Squad is of the 26 passenger configuration, with seats removed so that gear behind and in front of the camera had plenty of breathing room. How we can tell is through the difference in the number of windows. The 29 passenger bus had an extra window at the back. Even further, this is the low roof version, without the science of the time allowing for both headspace and greater air circulation, one of the reasons the Cooler got its name. Even further, a standard bus could be equipped as a kindergarten bus for use at primary or elementary schools, but the side passenger door doesn't have the lowered step designed for the smaller legs. Most buses coming out of the Japanese automaker and searchable through the interwebs are built standard with right-hand drive, but exported buses were built with a left-hand drive conversion, which Task Force X was more comfortable with, coming from the good old US of A. We'll put a boot in your... So while many of the egress doors, both for the standard and upper trim levels, are on the left-hand side on a right-hand drive vehicle, the left-hand drive buses have the passenger doors on the right-hand side. In Cuartel Maltese, we can imagine the ideal scenario of this bus being a diesel engine with the 3B type diesel unit. I'd like to say it was the higher powered DH diesel unit, but those were reserved for a 30 passenger conversion. Hold up, Josh, isn't diesel worse for the environment? I think that's a valid concern for many people. Diesel gets a bad reputation from the idiots who roll coal on the Teslas sitting next to them at stoplights. And from the Volkswagen scandal, widely referred to as Dieselgate. Because you can see the emissions of a diesel engine, namely the soot, it makes sense intuitively that it would be worse for the environment. That's not actually the case. There are more particulates per volume being released from gas exhaust than there is out of diesel exhaust. A gasoline car will emit nearly 10 times more carbonaceous aerosols out of the tailpipe than a diesel vehicle of comparable size. Though there are discrepancies on other particulate matter, and diesel can emit more nitrous oxide than gasoline cars. That's the stuff that smog is made from. At the same time, diesel fuel contains anywhere from 15 to 20% more energy per volume, even with a marginally, we're talking one decimal place, lower caloric value. And while diesel engines are generally heavier than a gas engine, they'll still result in being more fuel efficient. So, while you can see the emissions of a diesel engine, it's burning its energy-dense fuel more efficiently, and releasing less particulates per volume than a comparable gas engine. To be clear, all emissions are bad. Smog emissions are bad. Carbonaceous aerosols are bad. All emissions are bad. When it comes to producing less bad, it's the diesel engine. With that out of the way, let's talk specs, even if we don't really need to since it's a bus. The 3B type diesel engine has 3.4 liters shared between its 4 cylinders. This results in a 98 horsepower output, lower than the regular 22R gas engine or 2H diesel engine, which both provide 115 horsepower at the crank. The 3B engine can also achieve 160 pound-feet of torque, greater than the roughly 138 pound-feet of torque out of the gas engine, but that's just how diesel versus petrol works. With the 3B diesel engine, we can get rid of the optional B20, B30 model and call it a BB21 Toyota Coaster Standard. This bus didn't really need to do anything crazy. There were no chases and maybe one intense braking scene when they were going to rescue Harley, but other than that, this bus was a mellow-driven vehicle, if you were to compare it to any of my other picture cars videos. My goodness, I've gone through that whole breakdown and hardly mentioned anything concerning who this vehicle belongs to.
Who's Milton?
We know fairly little about our hero, Milton. We know he's lived in the tyrannical rule of both the Herrera family and Silvio Luna, and eventually joined the Maltese resistance in an attempt to overthrow the dictator-led government. We know that, likely, many of his friends were needlessly killed by Task Force X right before helping them in their mission to capture the Thinker and take down Project Starfish. We also know his experience behind the wheel of a passenger bus. Based on all of these knowns, is this the right vehicle for Milton? Why the heck not? He came to the jungle in a bus to pick up a bunch of people he didn't know, who just killed his buddies, transporting them on a mission to take down the Silvio Luna-led Corto Maltese government. There really is no justifiable manner to this logic. There's no way that I can line up any logic so that I can present an argument saying it does or does not. Your logic does not sound chicken sandwich. It's an inside joke. It doesn't mean anything. Don't worry about it.
I love inside jokes. Love to be a part of one someday.
But apart from the motivation behind why Milton might have this bus, we can look at the motivations behind why it was so great for the story. First off, their transportation needed to make sense for a large group without it being the Flying Fox funded by
Hunky Wayne guy.
Heck, they didn't even have any real funding or support from the US government. While there was talk about linking up with the Maltese resistance, they didn't run across any vehicles until the bus. And while they could have used the remains of the military convoy after capture, actually, no, they couldn't. The bus satisfied ulterior motives. It was colorful transportation for our band of misfits, progressing them from the dark green jungle lit by yellow firelight to the colorful capital of Corto Maltese. By being that intimate and cozy environment for the squad and progressing the color conceptualized by production design, it also fit the needs of the story. We're going to see some amazing work out of Beth Mickle in the future. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.